This channel is dedicated to talking about climate change, but normally I focus on two sides of that, namely the present and the future. And this makes sense. After all, the present is where we live, and the future is where we're headed. But sometimes it's important to put things in a little context, and there's a whole field of climate science dedicated to digging up Earth's past. And when I say digging up, I mean that literally. This field uses a host of artifacts to find out what happened. Just like paleontologists dig up and study bones, in paleoclimate, scientists uncover our climate history, long before we were measuring it with thermometers, let alone satellites. There's a reason I wanted to talk about this today specifically, and that's because this channel has just reached 10,000 subscribers. I am absolutely thrilled about this, and so I thought we'd go 10,000 years into Earth's past, a year for every single subscriber. There might also be a special 10,000 subscriber celebration, god that's a tongue twister, right at the end of this video, so stay tuned for that. Now, the first and most obvious question is, how have temperatures varied over all this time? To build up a picture of Earth's past, climate scientists use everything they can get their hands on. We're talking about tree rings, ice cores, and sediments. I mean, not this stuff specifically, this is all just junk I found around my house. The result? Well, you're seeing it right here, undulating up and down as the years pass by. These 10,000 years saw the rise of human civilization as our ancestors developed agriculture, started working with metals, began writing, developed mathematics, gave birth to philosophy, new art forms, and science. And all this while, nothing very exciting happened with globally average temperatures. Of course, there is some scientific uncertainty, but the undulations you're seeing are mere fractions of a degree Celsius. In fact, a pretty stable climate over these 10,000 years was a crucial factor in humans developing the civilization that we now know and, well, not love, but live in. But then human civilization took on a new development, the Industrial Revolution. And boom, we see temperatures shoot up. After the relative stability of the last 10,000 years, we can see just how unusual this rise is. In fact, in the dataset I've been showing, both the size and the speed of the change are unprecedented in this time period. Though it's worth noting that in some earlier datasets, some of these temperatures near the beginning are a bit hotter. Now, I know what you're thinking. Actually, no I don't, but I know what I'd be thinking if I were you, which is, but weren't there actually some substantial temperature changes over this time period, like the famous Little Ice Age about 1,000 years ago, or the medieval warm period which started about 500 years ago? Which is a really fantastic question. The thing is that those temperature changes only affected parts of the world. Compare that with global warming today and... ah, right, I guess that's why they call it global warming. Yeah, exactly. But let's look at the culprit behind these temperature changes, which is of course carbon dioxide, and you can see that ticking along right beneath me, although this time round I've sped it up because there's really not very much to see. It stays relatively constant throughout the 10,000 years to about 270 parts per million. And then, once again, the Industrial Revolution happens and carbon dioxide levels shoot up. Today, one out of every three carbon dioxide molecules is there because of human activities, whether that's burning fossil fuels or destroying forests. This change is absolutely massive in the historical context. In fact, carbon dioxide levels are now at the highest not just in 10,000 years, but in millions of years. To put that in some context, the last time carbon dioxide levels were roughly this high, your closest relative looked something like this.
Hello?
Now, I guess what you're probably thinking. Wow, my ancient relatives had great hair. Oh, no, that's not what I guessed you were thinking. Okay, but I do have a question. I mean, sure, we've seen both temperature and CO2 remain pretty stable for thousands of years and then both shoot up over the last century or so, but that doesn't prove anything. After all, correlation doesn't equal causation. Yeah, absolutely, but this correlation is only the tip of the rapidly melting iceberg of climate science. Our understanding of how carbon dioxide affects temperature comes from our understanding of the physical mechanisms of the greenhouse effect, something that we've known about for around 150 years, thanks to Joseph Fourier.
Hello?
Also, great hair. Data of Earth's recent past, as well as its distant history, just confirm what we already understood about the greenhouse effect. So you're saying we already knew how CO2 causes temperature changes, and this correlation just shows it playing out in practice? Exactly. But let's get back to looking at the last 10,000 years, because they haven't been completely stable. After all, if I was just going to show you a series of completely flat curves, I might as well just have shown you a picture of me in skinny jeans, although I think that would have sent me back a few thousand subscribers or so. Let's take a look at sea level rise, but this time let's rewind the clock. You can see the sea level rise since the Industrial Revolution. In fact, seas have already risen by about 20 centimeters and are accelerating as we heat the planet. But then we start to see what things were like before the Industrial Revolution, and let's rewind here because once again it's flat, flat, flatty McFlat face. That is until about 7,000 years ago, when suddenly that starts to change. The further we go back, the lower seas were. And this was a huge change. Sea levels rose by about 30 meters in 3,000 years. But with temperatures and carbon dioxide levels both relatively stable at this time, what on earth was going on? Well, you see, even though the last 10,000 years of temperatures have been pretty stable, that wasn't always the case. In fact, from around 17,000 to 10,000 years ago, temperatures rose substantially as Earth came out of the last ice age. And of course, as temperatures rise, so do sea levels. Here's a clip from my very first ever YouTube video to explain why.
That ice caps as well as mountain glaciers which sit on top of land. That means when they melt and the water runs into the oceans, sea levels will go up. Not only that, but the ocean's temperature is increasing. As water heats up, it expands a tiny bit. We may not notice that with the gin and tonic, but it can make a huge difference when it comes to something as massive as the ocean.
That's why sea levels rose in Earth's distant past, and it's why sea levels are rising today. But if temperatures had already leveled off 10,000 years ago, why were sea levels still rising? Well, that's because it takes a long time for oceans and ice to absorb that extra heat after the atmosphere warms up. That means that even after temperatures level off, the ocean still keeps climbing upwards.
So does that mean?
Yeah, it does. This is exactly what we can expect to happen with global warming today. Even after we've stopped emitting greenhouse gases and stopped heating the planet, we can expect seas to continue climbing upwards, quite possibly for centuries. Though exactly how much and how fast they continue to climb depends how much we've heated things up. Looking back at Earth's past helps put today's climate change in context, as well as giving us a preview for what's in store. And climate scientists use Earth's distant past to estimate how hot things will get in the future. This history shows just how extreme today's climate change is. We're currently heating the planet about 20 times faster than it warmed after the last ice age, and the consequences of our actions today will still be felt in millennia. But the past can only tell us so much, because what happens in the future depends on what we do in the present, how quickly we stop burning fossil fuels and flatten that CO2 curve. And I hope you'll stick around with me on this channel so that we can help create that future we want together. It is wild to me that 10,000 of you have already clicked that little subscriber button, and it is so touching when I get comments like these saying that I deserve even more. As I always say, if you want this channel to go from being under to overrated, then feel free to share these videos with friends, with family, and on your favorite subreddits and Facebook groups. Now for my final 10,000 celebration, I'm gonna see if I can still do a handstand on a skateboard. Okay, until next time. Bye.